former HOD and of Department of Gynae and Obs in Safdarjung Hospital. She was the Vice President FOCSI 2018, President Association of Gynae and Obs, that is AOGD 2015 and 2016. And we all have enjoyed that year beautifully. It was excellent. Scientifically, the content was so good all through the year. She is the member technical resource group and has done a lot of work on adolescent health, maternal health, contraception, comprehensive abortion care, maternal death reviews. She's collaborated in so many WHO projects as stillbirth registry, etc., maternal, perinatal. She's established, this is very important, established one of the first fully equipped obstetrical critical care unit in public sector. Pratima, you are going to be moderating along with your colleague. May I have the slide for Dr. Rekha Bharti? Yes. We have a dynamic personality here, Dr. Rekha Bharti. She is the associate professor at Vardhaman Mahavir Medical College and Safdarjung Hospital. She's an excellent academician. We've all made out from all the work that has gone in. Member for Multidisciplinary Subcommittee of AOGD 2018-20. Editor for NARCHI, Delhi Branch 2018-20. She's a past member coordinator, Multidisciplinary Committee of AOGD 2016-18. She's a co-editor for AOGD 2015-16. Excellent work done there. She's a nodal officer, PPT, CT, and at Safdarjung Hospital. Welcome to both of you. Please, you may start the panel now.
Thank you, Malvika. Thank you for the nice words. I think Rekha will have to share the slides now.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. And I'm just going to share my slides.
Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank Malvika and her team for giving me an opportunity and having confidence in me for, you know, conducting this panel along with Rekha. And secondly, the topic chosen was really, really good. You know, I had also learned so many things after, going through the vaccination schedules and so many things. It was a learning experience for me also. And before we start, I would like to introduce my panelists. All my panelists are, really stalwarts in their field, but I will be introducing them in alphabetical manner. So first of all, I would like to introduce Dr. Asmita Rathore. She is Director Professor and Head of the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Maulana Azad Medical College, New Delhi. She is basically a program coordinator for FNB in high-risk pregnancy also. She had more than 50 publications in index journals, and she's joint editor of 3 important books. Besides that, she was secretary AOGD in 2010-11, and she is very good in the maternal fetal medicine. Next, I would like to introduce Dr. Girja Wagh. She's a professor in Obs and Gyne at Bharatiya Vidyapeeth University Medical College, and she's a consultant at Cloudline Apollo Hospital, Pune. She's director of the Girja Hospital and Fertility Center, Kothad. She has got so many prizes, awards to her credit, and she is basically member of the steering committee of the World Organization of Gestosis. She is assistant coordinator of National Eclampsia Registry. She is a chairman of the Medical Disorder in Pregnancy, and she has been examiner to our Safdarjung Hospital many times, and she's a great friend. So, and she has been, basically a pioneer for influenza vaccine by a certain company. So next is, I would like to introduce Dr. Jyoti Bhaskar, a very cheerful person, very good, poet. I must say she writes so well. She's a principal consultant at Apollo Cradle Hospital, Indirapuram, Delhi NCR. She's a member of Safe Motherhood Committee of AOGD and of Endometriosis Committee of AOGD. And she's also executive member of NARCHI, Vice President of Delhi Gynecological Forum, and faculty of MRCOG course. Besides that, she has got many gold medalists and, Abdul Kalam Appreciation Award to her credit. Dr. Jyoti Bhaskar. Next, Kiran. Again, Kiran is a very, good friend of mine and very well known nationally. She's director professor at the Department of Obstetrics and Gynae at GTB Hospital. She's vice president AOGD in 2017-18. She's honorary secretary NARCHI 14-16. organized conferences at the FOCSI BOH conference in 2017. She has got many international session awards from Tokyo, and she's a young scientist. She has won Young Scientist Award also, and she has got more than 140 publications to her field, and her, again, field of interest is high risk pregnancy and environmental studies. She has got many publications on pesticides and air pollution. And then we have the pioneer, Dr. Nirja Bhatla, pioneer in HPV infection and vaccination. She is professor and unit head at Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, AIIMS. She is Secretary General, International Federation for Cervical Pathology and Colposcopy, Council Member AOGN, Council Member of Association of Gynae Oncology, Chairperson FIGO Gynae Oncology Committee, and most of important is, I said, she had got guidelines for cervical cancer in the published guidelines in the recent years, and she's passed and she's got national corresponding editor of Jogi, past president of Asia Oceania Research Organization. So many credits to her. I think the list is too big, so I will just say she's a well-known personality, and we'll proceed further. So coming to the top, coming to the topic, we have already, Dr. Dinesh has already discussed few important points, but I would like to say here that we have to focus on two types of vaccines, which we have. One is the basically the live attenuated vaccine, in which the virus is destroyed to such an extent that their infectivity is lost, but the live virus are introduced in the vaccine. The second is the inactivated vaccine, where the inactivated organisms are introduced as a vaccine. So, and we will be using, mainly we will be discussing the situations in which we come across in our day-to-day practice. And those situations, how we deal with those situations, the schedule has already been discussed. And secondly, my approach will be life course approach. So life course approach will be like we have started with from childhood to adolescent, and then we will be talking about in the pre-pregnancy, pregnancy, and in the old age. So I will start with Dr. Nirja Bhatla first. So Dr. Nirja, what all vaccines are recommended in adolescents? If you will tell us about both the situations, if the primary childhood immunization is complete, or if you are not sure about the childhood immunization. Dr. Nirja, please.
Dr. Pratima, thank you for such a warm introduction, and thank you to Dr. Kaul for telling us such a wonderful way, so many things, and revising our entire knowledge of the vaccinations. And when you were introducing me, actually, I realized that what should be most pertinent for today's talk is actually that I'm a member of NTAGI, which is the National Technical Advisory Group on Immunization. And we currently also have, I've been a member of the subgroup for HPV vaccine. Currently, we have on maternal influenza vaccination very active, and so on, as well as a member of the Strategic Advisory Group of Experts Subcommittee for HPV Vaccine in WHO. But anyway, so it has been a very nice talk. And coming to my question, which you have asked now about the vaccines recommended in adolescents. So if we look at the current status of adolescent immunization in India, and if we see what comes from the NFHS-4, which we had 2015-16 data, only 62% of children aged 12 to 23 months are really fully immunized. And if you look at the state and district level immunization coverage in India, it ranges from as high as 91.3% in Pondicherry down to 35.7%, only about a third in Nagaland. So this is the current status we have. There is no adolescent specific immunization schedule really devised by the government of India. And IAP vaccines, we heard such a nicely the whole schedule, but really the ones which are considered mandatory by the IAP, the important ones really are the Tdap or the TD and the HPV vaccination, which is recommended, but these are not really available widely in the government situation. But now if you don't know what the childhood immunization status is, then the recommendations for the catch-up immunizations would include the MMR, the hepatitis B, the hepatitis A, the typhoid conjugate vaccine, and the varicella. And now for the MMR, really, you might wonder about many people, are they rubella immune or not, which is really an important thing for us as obstetricians. And there is a possibility, of course, that you can do the testing of the antibodies. And then there will be many who will say that it is more expensive to do the antibody test, so why don't we just give another shot? And then there will be the anti-vaccine who will say, but why are we putting unnecessary extra adjuvant into the patient? So there will be these diverse thinkings. But broadly speaking, if there is a doubt about these things, these are very important because we do not want rubella in pregnancy. We do not want varicella in pregnancy. If there's a doubt that she is not vaccinated varicella and has not had, these patients should be vaccinated in adolescence so that they do not have this problem. So MMR, two doses at the 4 to 8 weeks interval, the hepatitis B, three doses. The hepatitis A has two doses, but there are combinations of hepatitis B and A which can be used. The typhoid conjugate, single dose, and the varicella, two doses at the 4 to 8. And then there are, of course, the special circumstances ones like the influenza vaccine, the JE vaccine, the pneumococcal vaccine. And if there is some exposure, then there is the rabies vaccine.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Nirja. And of course, we have to give a HPV vaccine, as you have already said, so in the adolescent age group. So basically, what we are saying that mandatory vaccine, the vaccine which are catch-up vaccines, and then vaccines in special situations, right? So in mandatory vaccine, it will be basically seen that you have to give HPV and you have to give MMR if it is not given earlier, and you have to look for influenza, and especially in the high-risk cases, right?
Right.
So next we move to Dr. Girja.
Yeah.
Dr. Girja, if we have a 25-year-old woman who is coming to you for a preconceptional advice, she has complete immunization till the age of 5 years and no vaccination done after 5 years except a dose of TT 5 years back after minor road accident. So what all vaccination will you advise her? What advice will you give her regarding conception? And if she wants to conceive after 3 months, will you change the vaccination schedule?
Ideally, whatever Dr. Nirja Bhatla madam said just now, the same vaccinations, I would like to confirm whether the woman is up to date or not, because we must very, very vigorously promote adult vaccination, which is hugely lacking in our practices currently. So before she embarks upon pregnancy, it would be ideal that at least she has taken the hepatitis B and the rubella vaccine that we can definitely offer her. And then this can be a window of opportunity when we can stabilize her weight, screen her for diabetes and hypothyroidism, start her on folic acid and calcium vitamin D supplements, because that's really going to help her. And then give her instructions about periconceptional important period. So that would be what would be my advice. And if she wants to conceive after 3 months, will you change the vaccinations? Actually, no, because currently there is a lot of query about the rubella vaccination being given inadvertently. Sometimes the rubella would be given and the patient would turn up with a pregnancy. Nothing is to be worried in such a situation. It is absolutely safe to continue her with that thing, because today, if you look at the global consensus, even just about 1 month's 1 month period is allocated, while guidelines are mentioning 3 months. But in case, because there have been certain cases which have been referred to us wherein the doctors have advised them to undergo termination, there's no need to do so. Even the same thing holds true with the HPV vaccine. Even if the patient is undergoing an HPV vaccine protocol and she conceives, doesn't matter, she can still continue and then maybe complete her dosages after she delivers. I would also like to talk about varicella here, because if at all we are finding that that is a seasonal kind of an appearance, it's always a good practice to give a varicella before she conceives, because that would be an opportunity. If she says after 3 months she's going to plan a baby, that would be a great thing to have. And I would also want to recommend that these vaccines are very much, all the adult vaccination program for women is being put on the FOXI website. We have a good clinical practice recommendation about adult vaccination pan the age of women. And this is something that we must definitely refer to in our practices. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Girja. I think you have explained it very clearly. And here I would like to say one important thing is that you have to understand, the patients have to understand that all live attenuated vaccine, though we are saying that they should be avoided in pregnancy, but the infectivity is comparatively much, much lower. So generally only in few certain cases, this can really cause the disease. Otherwise, very rare cases, it can cause the disease. Otherwise, it most of the cases, it will be effective vaccination, effective immunization, but without any disease process.
Can I add something?
Yes.
Okay. So as far as this lady has come to us preconceptually, the question you asked that if she's planning to get married after 3 months, would it change something? Yes. So as the ACOG and CDC have said that the Tdap, if she has not received, because she has not received the Tdap, she's got immunization only till 5 years. And we know that she's likely to get pregnant after 3 months. We can withhold Tdap in the preconception and give it to her when she's pregnant. That's the only thing I would say, that there can be a mild change.
An excellent point. Good point, Dr. Jyoti. Thank you. So now we'll move on. Dr. Rekha, next question.
Yeah, next question is, I would like to direct this question to Dr. Which vaccine is prescribed annually? So is it mandatory vaccine which is prescribed annually?
Okay. So I think before I answer this question, I must thank Dr. Malvika for inviting me for this forum. Because, after going through this, I realized that how much inadequate I am as an obstetrician, because I really don't talk much about the vaccines with my patients. So it's really a wake-up call for me. And as far as the annual vaccine is concerned, it is a seasonal vaccine, that is the influenza vaccine, which has been prescribed annually. And as per CDC, actually, they say you give it to everybody after the month, after 6 months of age, it should be given annually to everybody. And it is a pre-winter vaccine. So before the winter season starts, it should be given, say, about 1 month before the winter season starts. So if you look at the world, there are two hemispheres. One is northern hemisphere and one is southern hemisphere. Winter starts at different times in both these hemispheres. So for the northern hemisphere, the vaccine, would come around, say, month of October, because it covers the winter months from November to February. Whereas in the southern hemisphere, it will come in the month of March, when it will cover, the season of winter season from, say, July, August, or June, July, August. But the problem, initially we were told, like WHO told, that probably we should, in India, follow the northern hemisphere vaccine. So initially we, were following the northern hemisphere, the vaccine would be given pre-winter, say coming in the month of October. But then later on, the few studies and few surveillance was done, then we found out that in India, it is a very interesting phenomenon. There are two peaks, influenza peaks. One is which is called as monsoon peak. So it occurs around, say, June, July. And there's winter peak as usual. So in India, you can have both the vaccines. So it depends when your patient has come to you. So if the patient has come to you while she's pregnant and it's around March time, then you give the southern hemisphere. And if she comes to you in the around October, so you give her the northern hemisphere vaccine. Another thing, as you said, should it be given to everybody? Like, or it is a universal thing that we should be giving? So the answer to that is, though CDC says that it should be given to everybody, but actually if you look at developing countries like ours, where there will be a lot of cost for its production, since it is an annual vaccine. So there, and every year there is a surveillance, the vaccine needs to be changed. So there will be cost of production, and I don't know how much population we can provide this vaccine with. So we came out we can say we have compromised on the situation. So we have picked up the groups which are high risk. So in those high risk groups, I think pregnancy is one of them. Apart from children, you have healthcare workers, pregnancy, and elderly population. And of course, certain other patients who are high risk, and that is why they should be given this influenza vaccine. So I think,
My question is, like, we have a 25 years old woman. So this is the month of September going on. She's married for 2 years and she's a known asthmatic. controlled on steroid inhalers. Now she is planning to conceive and she has never taken influenza vaccine. So she has come to you if in September. So will you give her vaccine in September or you will wait for the new vaccine strain to be launched and then give her vaccine?
See, the thing is now this patient has a condition, underlying condition, that is asthma, which is a chronic lung condition, and she actually needs steroid inhalers. So by that standard, actually she becomes a candidate for giving annual influenza vaccine. So I don't know when she will get pregnant, even if she's trying to, you know, have a planning a conception. So I think I will offer her this vaccine, which is coming in September, October. I will definitely offer her this vaccine. And then we will see when she becomes pregnant, what to do then.
Thank you, Kiran. I think here I would like to add one thing. You have answered, you know, like a pulmonologist's wife, because the you know, the recommendations are that one vaccine in the month of October. So that, but what we have discussed with our pulmonologist, and it is said that if the immunity lasts for a shorter time, you know, 7 to 8 months.
Absolutely.
Pains off. So if you, these patients who are at high risk, I think we can repeat the vaccination with another.
So what I was trying to say is, suppose now you've given her this vaccine, right now she's not pregnant. So this vaccine, you know, as it is, the vaccine has an efficacy of about 60 to 70%. It's never, because the strain never matches actually,
yes,
of the surveillance strain may not match the actual strain which comes.
Yes.
So, and the antibodies also wane off, like after a certain time, maybe right, after 6 months or 8 months. So now suppose she becomes pregnant in between, say after say 4 or 5 months, and by the time she reaches in her second or third trimester, that is the time when, you know, they are much more vulnerable to the effects of influenza. If they have the morbidities more, the respiratory morbidities more, and then they have chances of, you know, harm to the fetus in the form of stillbirths or premature births. And also, like, we want them to have the benefit of vaccine in those months, because then the immunity can be passed on to the neonate also. So we call it as a vaccine which passes on the triple benefit to the one to the mother, another to the fetus, and another to the neonate for the first 6 months. So I think then there won't be any harm in repeating the new vaccine in her late second or early third trimester when the new vaccine has come with a fresh strain. This is what I think, that is what I should be offering to the patient, because there is nothing written as black and white in the text if you go.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am, it's true that there are no recommendations on repeating the vaccine, but considering that in India we have two peaks and we are giving this vaccine, had she not been asthmatic, we would have probably waited for the new vaccine to be available, and when she was pregnant, we could have given that vaccine. Second thing is, ma'am, I would like to know, is live attenuated vaccine against influenza is available in India?
So actually now it has been withdrawn. Earlier it used to be available, but since there is no demand, so there is no production, and it has got some limitations also. So nowadays it is not available in India.
So what are the disadvantages of live attenuated vaccine?
So actually,
because it is was available, and
Earlier it was available. You know, it's the kind of nasal spray which can be very easily given, so you don't have to inject. No, there is no pain. And also, if there is a pandemic, then it is a very good vaccine that it can be easily. You know, you can do the mass vaccination. But another thing which I think about the live vaccine, which is a good thing, is probably it is more immunogenic because it has a local effect as well as it produces antibodies in the blood. But the problem is that it is, has a lot of contraindications, and pregnancy is one of them. And otherwise, also, there are a lot of other conditions where you cannot use it. The list is quite big. So that is why probably it is not being used. So now what we have is an inactivated quadrivalent vaccine, and that is contains two strains of H1N1 and then A, and two strains of B which are currently available.
So my next question is to Dr. Asmita Rathore. Ma'am, a 20 years old woman who's married for 1 year, she comes to us for HPV vaccination. So what vaccination schedule which will you advise her? Dr. Asmita is there?
This madam is there.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Malvika for involving me in this panel. And I would agree with Dr. Kiran that this was really a very good brainstorming exercise for all of us, all clinicians, all obstetricians, that we don't take vaccines very seriously, except for HPV. Anyway, coming to the question, she's a 20-year-old woman. It means she has already, it's a catch-up immunization, and she has lost that opportunity of a primary recommendation, which says that this vaccine's efficacy is best if it is given in adolescent age group of 9 to 14 years and before first exposure or before the beginning of a sexual activity. So for this woman, the schedule will be 3 doses. And depending on the type of vaccine, whether it's a bivalent or quadrivalent, the schedule will be 0, 1, or 2 months, and then 6 months. So that will be the schedule.
So now, ma'am, this patient tells you that her husband has moved to US and she is also planning to join him in the month of February. So that means only 5 months from now, she'll be leaving India, but she wants to complete her vaccination schedule before that. Should we do some modification in the immunization schedule for this patient?
We do have some flexibility of modifying the immunization schedule with the... Though there is no guideline as to what is the maximum duration over which the immunization is should be complete, but it should generally be 12 to 15 months. There are definitely specifications as to minimum period between the 2 doses of the vaccine. The minimum interval between dose 1 and dose 2 is 4 weeks. Dose 2 and 3 is 12 weeks, and between 1 and 3 is 5 months. So for this woman to have an immunization which is most can be most effective for her particular age, the minimum interval between her first and third dose should be 5 months, and that she should take precaution before she leaves.
Yeah, so she can complete her course before she leaves India.
Yeah.
She didn't come back to you for her third dose, and she has taken her third dose after 4 months of the first dose. So that means the minimum period which was required for 5 months has not been, was not there. So what should we do?
Well, in this situation, if in a schedule of 2 doses, we need to repeat. But whether the fourth dose should be given to this woman or not, I'm not very sure. I didn't see any guidelines regarding that. We have an authority, Dr. Nirja, with us. Maybe she can highlight on this particular point. I have never encountered such situation in clinical practice yet.
Dr. Nirja, madam, would you like to say?
Yeah, I agree with Dr. Asmita that really we don't have guidelines for this, because guidelines are basically based on data. And in HPV vaccine, we have a vaccine where we don't really have what is called the correlate of protection. We cannot test how much antibody there is, and we don't know how much antibody minimum is really required. So I think in any case, as Dr. Asmita very rightly said, our target population is the one which is adolescent age group before sexual activity. And here you have a situation where you have an older age group who anyway has decreased efficacy. So it's a moot question, really. It depends a lot on the patient profile also. If she wants to spend on one more dose, then she can go ahead and take one more dose. But it does not do away with her need for screening either way. So personally, I would say that it's enough now. What is done, carry on with the screening in the proper fashion. But if the patient doesn't have an objection to taking an extra dose, that option can be there.
Yeah, ma'am, recently the CDC 2020 guidelines, they said if a patient has taken the dose before the minimum period which is required for the efficacy, then it should be repeated. So as a general rule,
they should repeat. Yeah. That's why I said if she doesn't mind taking one more dose.
They have applied to HPV also.
As it is, she's a candidate.
The minimum required.
It's more important to do this for the ones who are younger. And then we are in an era where we are saying that maybe we'll eventually settle to a single dose.
Yes.
And already that recommendation has also come from SAGE last year, a soft recommendation that you can do one dose and repeat after 3 to 5 years. So, you know, it's all really quite flexible.
So we have to see the cost of the vaccine also and whether the patient wants to spend money on it or not. Thank you, ma'am. So next question is to you, ma'am, Dr. Nirja. Now, patient has conceived in the month of December. Within 3 months, she conceives. she has not taken her third dose. So when will you give her third dose of her vaccine?
Now this pregnancy is not a time when we can give the vaccination. And moreover, we are finding data suggesting that a larger gap is better and they have better responses with the larger gap. So we should not worry about it at all. Reassure the patient, all is well. After her pregnancy is over, she can take the third dose.
She can take it in the postpartum period also.
Yes.
So, but patient doesn't take to you after 3 years and request to complete her vaccination. So how many doses of vaccine will you give? She has received 2 doses already. And does she need to restart the vaccination schedule? Part of it has already been answered, but I just...
No. We don't restart the vaccination schedule and we'll just give her the 1 more dose.
The basic rule which goes for all vaccination, that if a patient has missed a particular dose, it is recommended that only that dose is to be repeated. The schedule is not started all over again. And that has to be followed for all the vaccines, in fact. So, ma'am, this is a question, like it is, Para 3 was diagnosed with ascus and now at the next follow-up visit, her repeat pap smear is negative. She wants to take HPV vaccination. So what will be your advice to her?
So now she must really be very, very clear that HPV vaccine is a prophylactic vaccine. Now, if she thinks that because she has an ascus and she takes the vaccine, it's going to help her with her ascus, that we are very, very clear, it is not. So if she is taking this vaccine, now she is taking it for future infections. It is not going to do anything for this. So as such, it is licensed till 45 years and she can take it. But we must understand again the limited benefit, because already, if she is affected with one HPV type, it's not going to protect that type. It is going to protect another type. In my personal experience, we have used this license of 45 years really for those women who are going to have a late second marriage and now they're entering into a new relationship, and that type of patients more often. This type of a situation of the 40-year-old with an ascus is a relatively rare one for us.
So though there are no recommendations on it, but it has been said that even if a patient is HPV positive and you give the vaccine, it will protect her against other strains of HPV infection. So
same applies to ascus, same applies to a proven CIN or treated CIN, that maybe they will have less rates of recurrence because the other type is protected. But this particular one, they have to get it treated and not wait ke HPV vaccine lagaya. We'll see, maybe it will sort it out.
So the screening schedule, even if the patient is taking HPV vaccine, needs to be followed. Ma'am, are there any recommendations for immunocompromised or HIV positive patient that schedule is different for them, or they can follow the same schedule?
Well, this is the same schedule. Basically, what is important is for the younger than 15 year old. So because for them, now we have a 2 dose schedule. As Dr. Kaul very kindly pointed out, it was our IARC funded study in India, which provided a lot of the evidence to WHO to do that. So under 15 years of age, although I can tell you that more data coming from our study says even up to 18, maybe 2 doses is fine. But right now, what is the recommendation? And we are always safe if we follow the recommendation in case of any medical, legal or any complication. So under 15 years is 2 doses. But if they are HIV positive, then they must get 3 doses regardless of the age.
Yes, that's true. In immunocompromised patients, we have to give 3 doses even in the younger age group.
Yes, it may be HIV. It may be that they have a transplant patient who is receiving some drugs for immunosuppression, etc.
I just thought of sharing a study I came across. It was published in 2020. Very interesting study, though the power of the study is not that much because it was not a randomized study. They had just given vaccine, HPV vaccine, to the women who were coming for colonization for HSIL. And the basically randomization was not there. Only those patients who could afford, they took the vaccination and the others didn't take. But they saw that the chances of recurrence or persistent HSIL were much lower in the women who received HPV vaccine. But anyway, this is a preliminary data, so we need to wait, and there are no recommendations to give vaccine to these kind of patients. My next question is to Dr. Jyoti. What is the advised vaccination schedule for Tdap in adults?
So as far as the Tdap is concerned, one injection in one lifetime is considered to be enough. So we need to ask the patient if she's received that as an adolescent, or if she has received during pregnancy or a postpartum period, then she does not require any further Tdap during the adulthood. So during the whole adulthood, if a patient has never ever received a Tdap, then we will give them one shot of Tdap. So that is as far as that is concerned.
Okay, ma'am, actually recently, like CDC had said, though in India, we are still, the government of India guidelines are more for TD than Tdap, that we should give one TD as we were giving tetanus toxoid. So in place of tetanus toxoid, we can give one TD every, we have to give one TD every 10 years. So that is basically replacing tetanus toxoid. But similarly, the guidelines have come up, though not in India, because we don't have it available in the government supply, that you can replace TD vaccine with Tdap vaccine. So Tdap That's vaccine it. Can be given every 10 years.
10 years, yes.
Yeah. That's so now right. This is a patient who has conceived and she is very well vaccinated. She has followed all her immunization schedule and she received Tdap vaccine 10 years back and she's planning to conceive. So will you give her Tdap right now preconceptionally, or you will wait for the dose to be given at 28 weeks of pregnancy?
Now, as I said, that she already has received a Tdap injection previously. So this particular Tdap injection that she has received will help in the cocooning. But if you're looking for a pregnancy, then I will wait for her to be pregnant and then give her a Tdap between 27 to 36 weeks of pregnancy. And the main aim of giving Tdap during pregnancy is to provide antibodies to the newborn fetus between 0 to 6 weeks and to protect the baby from pertussis during that particular time. So yes, I will wait till the pregnancy and then give her the
dose. Now, ma'am, this was a very tricky question actually. And now here, people may be divided in their views because see, she may not conceive that rapidly. And for needs a Tdap because she has not received it for 10 years now. And diphtheria, they say now they are emerging in the developing countries. So I think even if we give her Tdap right now for her own protection, because we do not know whether she'll conceive in 2-3 months or she may take up to 6 months or more to conceive. So we can give her like this is something, you know, very tricky question, because then people say so many of tetanus toxoid doses being given and doses being repeated. For acellular pertussis, it is known that the vaccination doesn't last much. The levels they keep falling, start falling in 6 months or so. So that is why they have recommended that in each pregnancy, Tdap has to be given. So these are recommendations, yes, CDC recommendations. And for the government of India also, like they have given the recommendations now that patient can be given instead of TT, which we were giving previously, we have to replace it with the TD. So, and WHO rather had recommended in 1998 that all TT vaccines to be replaced with TD vaccine. And no longer be available from January 2020. But they said that whatever the stock we have or TT vaccine, we can start the stock just to shift over to TD vaccine. And this recommendation was on the observation that even from India between 1997 to 2012, the number of diphtheria cases which were reported to WHO increased from 1326 to 2525. So the reason for this increase is not known, but it was primarily seen in developing countries. And now even developed countries have switched over to Tdap. In India, like we can, if a patient TD, we'll be getting in the government supply also. And we are getting at many places right now also. And I think we can offer her Tdap. Anyone wants to differs on this account? Any panelist wants
Rekha,
to?
Rekha, I would like to add something here, that as you are saying that pertussis vaccine per se is, you know, mainly the women are carrier. You know, the adults are carriers basically. And this is harmful for the child, which whenever they are born, and the window period is there. You know that Dr. McCall has also talked about that window period, that the pertussis vaccine is given at the one month of age, and that period is very important, critical for that child. So I think I would agree with the Jyoti also that I mean, if the patient cannot, you know, take two doses, then we must, you know, postpone it to the, you know, pregnancy stage, because that is the more important stage. And if she is in contact with a young baby, young children, then I think you should focus on giving it in the preconceptional also. But otherwise, I would prefer it to be, if the patient cannot afford two doses, then I would prefer it to be given in the, you know, later half of pregnancy.
Yeah, so if you really say, as far as all recommendations goes, it's only the CDC which says TD or TDAP every 10 years. But if you look at all the bodies, whether it's RCOG, whether it's ACOG, whether it's FOCI, everyone says that the TDAP has to be given at the adolescent period, then in the cocooning period if they're coming in contact with an infant within 12 months of age, or in the pregnancy, and in every pregnancy it has to be done. And yes, T is the one that has to be repeated every 10 years. But yes, if you have an option to give a TDAP, I don't know how much maternal, personally, for adult, it's going to protect against pertussis, but the main aim of giving it is to protect the newborn between 0 to 6 of age.
Absolutely. So yeah. Actually, if we go by the cost and we do not want to give Tdap, anyway, her tetanus is due at 10 years. So we have to give once she has come to us. So because she has received tetanus 10 years back. And when we talk about giving the tetanus during pregnancy, we always have to consider that she may abort or she may go into preterm labor. So that period also we have to cover. So I think some vaccination containing tetanus toxoid she needs, whether we give TT or we give TD or we give Tdap. So that is a different thing, because Tdap generally we are not giving outside pregnancy. So it could be like if all TT is being replaced by TD, so we can give her TD right now and then later on. So now there is another tricky situation, and this is a real-time situation. I have not cooked up the situations. These, most of these cases, they have come to us in OPD and they have been taken. Only circumstances have been changed. Otherwise, the condition is... So this was a 30-year-old patient. She was second gravida, para 1. She had a cesarean 4 years back. And during that pregnancy, she received 2 doses of tetanus toxoid. She comes to us at 30 weeks gestation. She has already received 2 tetanus toxoid in this pregnancy at 4th and 6th month. And now she has learned from somewhere that between 28 to 36 weeks, she has to receive a Tdap vaccine. So she comes for consultation whether she can receive or not. So what is like...
Yes, I agree with you, Dr. Rekha. This is a common problem just because people are not yet aware about it. So they are not counseling properly. And hopefully in the next few months, this information dissemination that we are doing is going to help to decrease this type of situation. But yes, I would say that yes, she can still get the Tdap, even she had the 2 doses of TT. Because the extra dose of TT that will go in is not going to harm her, but the benefits that she will get for her baby, as has been nicely explained, that will far exceed. So it will be better that she can get that at the 28 weeks period.
Yeah, that's true, ma'am. So in fact, with multiple doses of TT, they said there is a theoretical risk of getting severe local reaction or even Arthur's reaction. And theoretically, it has been said that there could be serum sickness kind of a problem also with this. But multiple studies have been there. And in fact, when I was looking for the studies, I was basically coming across very old studies, because this kind of situation which is coming in India probably is not coming abroad in the Western countries nowadays, that people are taking multiple doses of tetanus toxoid. So many of these papers were old papers, and there they had seen that even if the patient had received multiple doses of tetanus toxoid, it was only the local reaction which was there. So we can give her the benefit of taking diphtheria and those and pertussis.
In your case already, she has received at 6 months, so we can give it at 28 weeks. If somebody has received it a bit later, we can see that there's a 4-week interval given. Because in the West, they had done away with TT altogether. They don't give TT anymore because they don't see this problem. So their situation is a little different from ours.
Okay. So we go ahead with the next question. Dr. Kiran Guleria. Ma'am, this is a primi gravida. She comes to us at 6 weeks gestation for MTP. As she conceived within 2 months of receiving MMR vaccine. So is MTP indicated for this reason, and how will you counsel her?
So I think as partly the question has been answered by even our by our pediatrician and by some, I think the first response to your first question. So if you look at the question, she is 6 weeks now and she received the MMR vaccine 2 months back. So probably she's conceived in that, you know, the prohibitory period of say 28 days or 1 month. So technically what we tell them, yes, don't conceive in that period. So she's conceived in that period. But the answer to this is a very convincing no. She does not require any MTP for this reason. And to counsel her, I think we can also put some evidences there which can help us to counsel her. We have now registries where the MMR vaccine pregnancies are reported, and whatever happens to the, if there is any adverse effect reported, that is there in the registry. And WHO also has got that registry. And based on that, I think we can very safely and reassuringly tell her that the theoretical, what is the theoretical risk with MMR? Since it is a live attenuated vaccine. So the theoretical risk is that of, say, congenital rubella syndrome or miscarriage or maybe later on some fetal growth restriction. But practically, these pregnancies have been studied and there is not even a single case of congenital rubella syndrome reported with MMR vaccine. That is one. Secondly, whatever the evidence they have is there, they have seen that this may, like you may find this, you know, like antigen in either in the amniotic fluid or maybe cord blood, but it never produces any disease in the fetus. So it causes no harm to the fetus. We can say what by whatever evidence we have so far, but still, you know, in any, whenever we are giving any evidence or any scientific talk, we can never be 100% sure, but we can tell her that she can be reassured. We haven't seen such things. She can continue with the pregnancy. There is no need to do an MTP. But of course, we will monitor her pregnancy very closely. We'll do her 11 to 13 week scan, look at her detailed anamnesis scan and do her fetal growth scans and follow her in this pregnancy. But rest assured, I think she can be fine and will do very well in the pregnancy.
Can I say something, Dr. Prasima? Because I have had a real-time experience of getting into an inadvertent such kind of an injection to a patient who had conceived with IVF pregnancy. And then it so happened that she was administered the rubella vaccine instead of the flu vaccine at 13 to 14 weeks of gestation by the nurse by mistake. And this was then brought to the notice by another physician, you know, and she expressed a surprise. And that took the patient on, and we had to answer a lot of questions, and I had to show her a lot of evidences. And you know what the patient's argument was, that even if you keep screening my baby, are you going to be able to screen in utero for deafness, dumbness, or any of these things which are going to occur with the rubella infection? And so we had to just give her an assurance. What happened resultantly was that she delivered a very healthy baby, but I lost that patient, you know, to some other consultant. So in case there has been an inadvertent administration by a colleague, please don't be alarmed or say something which is, you know, not very nice, because that is very important currently in the medico-legal climate, that we are very, very, you know, rational and balanced when we speak and react to such kind of things, because these are human errors which are sometimes absolutely which may happen in a context. Only thing is we should definitely be a little careful, because finally, vaccination happens to be an intervention would be my sort of a take on this. Thank you.
So I think, I agree with you, Dr. Girija, that is why we need to update ourselves with the vaccines so that we are, you know, well prepared to give all answers, and we should be
and
able
to. And it is very, very unfortunate that sometimes our colleagues have advised patients to undergo termination for IgG antibodies coming in high titers or vaccines given indeterminately, something which we must definitely not encourage.
This was actually my next question, which Dr. Girija has already answered, that a patient was, and actually it was her question. See, she only suggested me this question, that she had come across this kind of a patient. That's why I had put it here in the discussion.
I would like to ask Dr. Kiran, that would you like to do the antibodies if you have given, you know, given such patients in the first case? Would you like to do the antibodies?
right now, I think she's
always say do our IgG, IgM antibodies, and you know, when the patient has conceived after giving the vaccination.
But I think now she has received this vaccine. I don't know. Initially, if you see any response to vaccine, it will be IgM, which will rise initially. And I'm not really sure whether that is going to help.
See, ma'am, if there is rise in the IgM titers also, that means vaccine was effective. So we need not do these because it is not going to change our management in these cases.
Exactly.
So this is what accidentally received also. So you don't have to panic, and you just have to assure, and you have to provide them the evidence that this thing is can
happen.
Is what Dr. Nirija said in her beginning statements was, we have to be, even if it's a live vaccine, it is an attenuated vaccine, and this is something that we must always remember.
Yeah.
So in fact, you know, in the second case, you can tell them more convincingly that you have received it rather in fourth month. So
yeah.
Now, whatever theoretical risk of congenital, that is also very, very less.
Yes.
So that is the additional thing which you can add in your counseling. And so otherwise, rest of the things will be same.
Yes, ma'am. You're very right, ma'am. So live attenuated vaccines, they are known to cross the placenta, but fetal damage has not been reported. Till 2012, there were 3,500 women who were reported to have received inadvertently vaccine against rubella shortly before or in early stages of pregnancy, but there was no case of congenital rubella syndrome reported in these pregnancies. So even if someone has received this vaccine, there is no need to advise termination to that patient. So now we move on to our next case, Dr. Girija. This is a 26-year-old primi gravida with 20 weeks gestation, and she gives history of jaundice in her husband, who has tested HBs antigen positive. She is HBs antigen negative, and she has completed her primary immunization during childhood. What advice will you give her? Does she need any boosters and immunoglobulins, or what will you advise her?
Ideally, hepatitis B would be a part of a preconceptional and as well as pregnancy vaccination protocol. And even if she has been protected, her primary immunization has been done in the childhood, I would still want to give her a sort of a catch-up vaccination now during her pregnancy. Also, it's safe to be given. And if she would have come to me preconception also, I would have given it to her.
Yes, ma'am. Very rightly said. And now
this... just share with you, Pratima madam is a very dear friend, but you know, I must share this thing, is hepatitis B is a part of my regular vaccination protocol for all antenatal mothers. I give it at about 20 weeks of gestation.
So now for this question, then is already answered because you are routinely giving hepatitis B in pregnancy.
Yes.
If a woman has taken hepatitis B 0 and 1 month dose before pregnancy, and can she take the dose 3 during? It has already been answered. Yes, ma'am.
He has already answered it.
So, next. So, the CDC also recommends that vaccination of adults at risk of HB infection include from HPV, even without acknowledgement of the specific risk factors. And in this case, we have risk factors present, so we can safely give this vaccine to the patient. And although it is said that the immunological memory of this vaccine, it remains, there was one study, but I couldn't get the reference of that, so I not put it. For 30 years also, it has been reported. And even if the levels are low or they are declining, it has been seen that when the patient gets is exposed to the virus, the immunization, that there is increase in the antibody formation. But still, studies are going on to assess whether booster dose will be needed in future or not. But yes, in pregnancy, we cannot take risk. This patient has is having a high-risk partner, so we have to give the vaccination to this patient. We cannot refuse. And there is also a study in which women have received vaccination in pregnancy, and in 1399 pregnancy where hepatitis B was administered, and it was given within first 5 weeks of pregnancy. There was no significant association of any maternal or fetal complication in these cases. I just wanted to, you know, just I came across this, so I just have written it here, that we should know that transiently patient can be HBs antigen positive, and it can be detected for up to 18 days after vaccination. And if the patient is on hemodialysis, it is seen that up to 52 days also this hepatitis B antigen may be positive in the blood. So it is said that the person should not donate blood in this period. Why? It is not that he'll infect others. It is basically otherwise he'll be, you know, for future donation also he'll be debarred. So it is, and this person should not get, you know, worried that why this positivity is coming. So this is a known fact. And second thing is the patients more than 20 years of age who are on hemodialysis, they have to be given double dose of the vaccination. Instead of 1 ml 20 microgram, we give 2 ml and 4 doses instead of 3 doses, because many of our patients we put on hemodialysis after delivery who have severe preeclampsia or acute renal failure. So I think it is important for the obstetrician to know that we should give this opportunity of vaccination to these patients. Dr. Jyoti, this is a 36 weeks pregnant woman. She has a 4-year-old child who gets chickenpox. And this patient has never had chickenpox, and neither she was ever vaccinated for varicella. So how will you manage this case?
So in this particular case, we have to look at two aspects. First of all is the fact that what is the significance of the contact, and the second, what is her status as far as the immunity is concerned. Now, if she has a child who's 4 years old who's staying with her continuously, we can expect it to be a very significant contact that she has had. Now, she does give history that she's never had chickenpox in the past, but studies have shown that 80% of these patients, if you do in varicella IgG levels, we find them to be immune. So the first thing I would do for this particular patient is to get her varicella IgG done to find out what her immune status is. If she's found to be a non-immune status, then I would like to counsel this patient and consider giving her varicella immunoglobulin. See, the varicella vaccine, it takes a long time. It's a live vaccine. It's contraindicated clearly. That is not an option for us. So the option that's only available is to get the immunoglobulins. So what counseling do I really need to tell her is this, that first of all, immunoglobulins are quite expensive and they're difficult to procure. The second thing is that if even after I give her an immunoglobulin, then she may have about 50% subclinical infection. They may have an attenuated chickenpox infection. And the main purpose of giving immunoglobulin is to protect the mother from the chickenpox and its complication of pneumonia, which occurs in 10 to 20% of patients. But as far as the effect it will have on the baby, preventing the baby if it's born from neonatal varicella, observational studies do show that it has benefit, but we do not have enough evidence to show that 100% protection is going to be provided. The immunoglobulin has to be given within 96 hours. We get the report of IgG within 24 to 48 hours, give them within 96 hours and up to maximum of about 10 days. The dose to be given is 125 units per 10 kg. So we expect our patient to be more than 40 kg. So the maximum dose, that's 625 units that has to be given. Now, each vial has approximately 125 units, that's 1.2 ml. So if you're looking about nearly about 6 ml of it has to be given. It has to be given only intramuscularly. It is not to be given intravenously. And since 6 ml is huge to be given, probably we can give it at two sites. Important to tell her that despite getting this particular immunoglobulin, she can still have chickenpox. So in case she does develop rash, she has to come back to us immediately, because then she will require a little help and she'll require to be taken care of. But unfortunately, if she does go into labor and she delivers within this particular period when she's got immunization, then the baby has to be given immunoglobulins also. So this is what I would advise.
Thank you, Jyoti. I think you've beautifully explained anything. Rekha, we have to be a little quick. You know, we have maybe many questions.
This is like, now she gives history that her mother-in-law had herpes zoster 1 month
back.
Could we have done something at that time?
See, actually, herpes zoster, we all think it's not infected, but we need to understand that if herpes zoster, anyone in the family has, it is on the exposed area, these vesicles are also infected. So at that particular time, probably we could have told this particular lady to keep the child, if the child was not vaccinated against varicella, and herself away from her mother till the particular vaccines have been done. At that time also, we could have done a varicella IgG and determined her immune status and told her to take precautions at that particular time.
So this we should all know, that herpes zoster lesions are infected. So, but it doesn't spread by airborne route. It is basically the fluid of the vesicle which is infective. So if that is touched by the child on the nose or the mouth, that carries the infection. But people who have disseminated form can have airborne route of dissemination also. And this could have been kept covered by the mother-in-law, and the contact with the child could have been avoided to avoid this kind of a situation. And So coming to varicella zoster immunoglobulin, as madam already said, that it will, there is no evidence that it prevents the viremia or the fetal syndrome, but it will suppress the infection in the mother. And if the baby is born and within 5 days preceding that or 48 hours after delivery, if the mother had chickenpox, then the baby needs to receive these immunoglobulins. This is important. Okay, now this is Dr. Asmita. Ma'am, this is a young physician who knows a lot about when organogenesis of baby takes place. She calls you around 8 p.m. in the night. It was a distress call that she is 6 weeks pregnant and had a dog bite 10 minutes back. And she was advised anti-rabies vaccination, but she's worried to take vaccination during organogenesis time. So, and she wants to avoid it for 2 weeks. So how will you counsel her? And if she takes this, if she takes this vaccine, is it an indication for MTP?
I think we can completely understand the apprehension of patient in taking any vaccination at 6 weeks of gestation. Rabies vaccine is an inactivated virus vaccine. And when we decide about the post-exposure prophylaxis, we need to understand there are multiple points which we need to take into consideration while advising the PEP. Important one of them is about the category of the wound, any past history of vaccination in the woman, and is the vaccination status of the pet or a dog which has bitten her. As far as counseling is concerned, we need to tell her that rabies is a fatal disease and she needs immunization. And depending on the category of a wound, the other care wound management is also critically important for the management of this particular woman. The vaccination is beneficial, it prevents rabies, and it is unlikely to harm the fetus. And so it can be given. She doesn't need MTP if she takes the vaccination.
So now the nerve cell vaccines are not there, which was basically the ones which were which were of harm. Thing. So this patient has to take, there is no reason that she will not take the vaccine. And if there is risk of exposure to rabies or vaccination doesn't pose any risk to the baby, it has been seen in various studies. So it is no reason for termination of pregnancies. Now, ma'am, we have already talked about which vaccine are contraindicated. This is just a rapid round of two, three questions. Which vaccines are contraindicated in pregnancy?
I think we have already covered most of the point. In general, all live attenuated vaccines are contraindicated in the pregnancy. And of these, BCG, oral typhoid, Japanese encephalitis are contraindicated. Varicella, there is a hypothetical risk, but inadvertent administration doesn't need, again, termination of a pregnancy with any of the vaccines. The vaccines which we don't normally recommend during pregnancy are HPV and yellow fever. However, and if HPV vaccination is ongoing when patient conceives, we stop it and give remaining dose after in the puerperium 6 weeks after delivery. For yellow fever, which is a live attenuated vaccine, we need to carefully evaluate whether she really needs to travel to an endemic area. And if she has to travel and it's an unavoidable travel, she still needs to be given vaccination. Then other vaccines, inactivated bacterial and viral vaccines, though they are not normally recommended, there is no need for termination of a pregnancy if they are inadvertently given during pregnancy.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much. Just a complete summary of it. And in the postpartum period, what vaccines should be given in the postpartum period?
Rekha, I just want to tell the audience that please put your questions in the question answer because the chat is not active at the moment. Rekha, continue.
Hanji, ma'am, Dr. Asmita. Hello. Hanji, ma'am.
Hello.
We were talking about vaccination in the postpartum period.
Normally we do not recommend per se any vaccination in postpartum period, but if women who are previously non-immunized for either rubella, HPV, hepatitis B, all of them should receive their vaccinations in postpartum period for subsequent protection.
Pratima, madam, I wanted to ask you one question because many times the old grandparents come asking and requesting for the flu vaccination as a cocoon kind of an approach. When there is a small baby inside, I think we must recommend and not promote, but at least support that. What is your call on that?
Yes, we also advocate that any, you know, relative, which is close relative, should be definitely given the vaccination, flu vaccine. especially
that TDAP and influenza.
Yeah, especially in the postpartum period, because there are old grandparents who want to be
both the vaccines, TDAP as well as influenza. Even TDAP vaccine is advocated by other countries when they are traveling to that country, like Australia all. You know, you have to take that vaccine. Old people, more than 60 years, they all have to be. All are old, you know. So we all have to take. You know, traveling to Australia or other countries.
But I think in these cases, if we give that cocoon vaccines, then we must give them 2 weeks time before they start handling the baby. That is also important.
Yes.
We have to take the
time. Yes.
So basically, no vaccine is contraindicated in the lactational period, in the immediate postpartum period. Rather, we should take it as an opportunity to give the catch-up vaccine. So this is one thing, you know, which I realized while preparing this panel discussion, that this is the golden time which we are, you know, losing.
You need to have 3 postnatal visits. And in your 3 postnatal visits, you can definitely complete the entire vaccination catch-up program.
Yes ma'am.
So last question.
Dr. Jyoti, which vaccines
in the postmenopausal?
So in the postmenopausal, again, this is one time that we can talk to them, ask them whether they've received the influenza vaccine. If not, give them annually. The second vaccine, we can talk about TD, and although I'm not too much favor of TDAP, but as Rekha says, TDAP. So it will be TD every 10.
Unless she's a grandmother.
And she more than 50 years never received a TDAP. Yes, then I would definitely take this opportunity to give her a TDAP at this particular time. And as Dr. Dinesh Kaul did talk about the pneumococcal vaccine for all who are above 50, that is the one that we are covering about the PCV13. And after 65 years of age, PCV13, and 1 year later, PPSV23 can be given. Yes, we do have something about the zoster vaccine also, but I don't know in India whether it's quite. So I believe 7,000 rupees. Otherwise, 2 doses of that after the age of 50 years. And then rest of the vaccines, we can ask about MMR, varicella, hepatitis. That depends upon the high-risk conditions of the patient.
Currently, just before COVID, did we give anything for our oldies? Because I did give pneumococcal and flu to my dad, who is old.
Flu vaccine only, you know, to all the patients who are high-risk patients, all the 60-year-old and above. All of us should also take.
Absolutely. I
think pneumococcal is only once. Pneumococcal is only once at 65 years of
age. So I think we have covered almost all the topics. I would now like all the panelists to give, you know, at least one line, you know, take-home message. Dr. Kiran, please.
So I think first of all, it is a learning experience for myself. I have woken up and now I think I'm in a better position to talk to my patients, what to advise and how to sort out their queries when they come to us. And now I'll be very, very careful, like even if I'm in a government sector. In fact, you know, some of the hospitals are not even getting TD, though Delhi government has recommended TD, but still be continuing with TT vaccination. So that is something which we've already put on a request to the government that it should be made available to all the hospitals. And I think it's more of a learning experience for myself, I would say, today. And the message, if we can pass on to the other obstetricians who are all listening to us, that would be, you know, I can say that we are successful today if we have passed on the message to them.
Thank you, Kiran. Dr. Girja.
All the opportunities to vaccinate your young adolescent, pregnant moms, postpartum, and even young menopausal, like us, all of us should use these opportunities to get vaccinated. And secondly, also be careful. There can be patients who say that we are anti-vaccine people. I have had 2 such patients who were completely anti-vaccine. So for them, it's okay. You have to just accept, write it on the paper that the patient doesn't want to take any vaccine. There's nothing to put a gun against her head or anything. But then we have to document it on the paper. I don't know what would be the, you know, what kind of additional concerns you need to take that maybe to guide us here.
Dr. Asmita, would you like to say?
Yeah. I think this panel was really a great learning exercise for all of us, and especially for me. My message will be, I think, for all obstetricians, includes myself, that in public sector we get very few opportunities for preconception counseling, but I would definitely like to use the puerperium and post delivery days to talk to the women and use it for and catch up immunization for subsequent period. Thank you.
Okay, and Dr. Jyoti.
Okay, ma'am. Since this, you know, I always now take a policy that as soon as a woman walks into my clinic, you see three words: think, ask, and counsel about vaccination. So I keep thinking, should I talk to about vaccine? What vaccination have you taken? And counseling. And with the COVID-19 coming, I realize that the uptake of vaccination has really increased. Every person knows the importance of vaccination. So if we take this particular time to really educate our patients, I'm sure the vaccination uptake will increase to nearly 100%.
Very nicely worded, you know, think, ask, and deliver. Dr. Kaul, I kept you waiting. So, sorry for that. But now we can take the question.
Thanks a lot. I was busy typing answers to most of the questions which propped up in the chat box. Thanks a lot for hosting me. In case there are some questions for the participants which have been not answered, then maybe we can answer them.
Ma'am, there are a few questions in the Q&A box. Pratima, madam, should I put on?
Yes, yes.
Ma'am, is hepatitis B booster is recommended for doctors conducting deliveries in hepatitis B positive patients?
Well, as a healthcare individual, you should check your NDHBS titers. Okay, if they are more than 10, then you are very well protected. Okay, the moment your titers drop, take an additional shot.
Okay.
What is more important is take universal precautions.
That's important.
That we should not falter upon.
Yes.
Ma'am, there is another question from Dr. Manju. Can we come out with a universal immunization schedule for pregnant women? Is government sector offering flu and Tdap vaccine in pregnancy?
Here I would say that government is advocating flu vaccine. Now, recently there is an article which is advocating flu vaccine, and they are advocating TD vaccine, but not more than that. That is not in the program. No other vaccines are there in the program. TD and flu vaccines are there.
But ma'am, as far as I know, the flu vaccine is not under the program.
No, it has come. If you look at the Ministry of Health website, in the flu section, it is there. Influenza section, I have seen. And because that, I put it for my hospital, and then they agreed to purchase it, flu vaccine for pregnant women also. So it
So because we are also getting it on request for purchase. But if you go to the dispensaries and all, they are only giving TD. Yeah.
Actually, it is not widely disseminated, this information, but it is there on the MHF do website in the influenza section that should be given to patients.
Should be given, yeah. But ma'am, the government is not spending money on it. No? So
my institute agreed.
That's the problem.
We are going to, you know, to call for tender. So I pick up.
Ma'am, there is another question from Dr. Ranjana Jha. She is asking if patient has taken two doses of TD vaccine at 4th and 5 month, then can she take Tdap vaccine at 28 weeks?
Dr. Jyoti, would you like to answer?
Yeah, madam, in this particular one, I don't know what, normally that if T1 and T2, you need a gap of 4 to 6 weeks, and from T2 to Tdap, you need a gap of 6 to 12 months. So if you have given it at 5 months, then giving the next dose is going to be a little too early. So I would prefer to give her at 36 weeks. So at 36 weeks, I have 2 weeks time to have enough antibodies and transfer to the baby instead of giving her at 28 weeks because she has just. That's my personal, because I know guidelines, so you all would be able to tell it better.
We all agree to that, ma'am.
Okay,
better giving her near her delivery, because tetanus she is already infected with, and it is the pertussis which we want in 2 weeks.
Now the things are becoming so clear, you know. Now we can plan, you know. Otherwise, in previous time, I would have said, okay, give it.
That's true.
I just want to add one thing. that it was very interesting panel discussion. And the thing which I learned was that which flu vaccine to be given in which month. That is northern and southern, right? That was very good, very good. Excellent panel.
Thank you. Ma'am, another question is there, that there is a woman and she is not knowing whether she has received hepatitis B vaccine or not. So should antibody titer to be done during pregnancy?
I don't know. I don't know, because we are testing HPSAG for all the pregnant women. University, we are doing that, but getting the titers, I think it's not advocated.
Actually, it says that you have to see the high risk status of the woman. If she is going to be staying with anyone who's HPS contact, or she has got multiple sexual partners, there are about 6 indications. I don't remember them offhand. If she has any of these 6 indications, then we need to give her in the pregnancy. Crossly, it is not indicated. Dr. Girja was saying she's giving to all patients, but that was her personal opinion, because I don't think anywhere it says that it is a part of the organization.
We also give to those patients only if the husband is hepatitis B positive, then in that case, of course, we can give.
Yes, high risk conditions, yes.
Ma'am, in that case, we'll be giving the booster dose. But if the patient is not sure of her primary immunization, it is better to give her the vaccination, because as far as getting antibody titers is concerned, this is also controversial, because they say even a person who is fully immunized and is protected also may have low titers, and when you get infection, these titers, they start rising. So this is a memory response which is there with the cells. So it is not that if the person has a low titer, the person has not.
I agree.
The paying status of our patients, it is better to give 3 doses.
It's better to get your surface antigen and give the vaccine.
Sorry, sir.
Yes. If she is not sure, it is better to give the vaccine in pregnancy.
Okay.
Ma'am, there are a few, 2-3 questions. Should I ask Pratima, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
Ma'am, during preconception counseling, should we routinely give MMRV and hepatitis A and B vaccine?
I think we have discussed this at length.
Hepatitis A, we have not discussed, but if the patient, for hepatitis A, if the patient demands hepatitis A, then we can give. It is basically for the high-risk places, endemic areas. And you know, in India, we have these pockets, and we do get patients of hepatitis. Specifically coming and asking, I think she should be given hepatitis A vaccination.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, what is the frequency of hepatitis B booster for healthcare workers?
There is no frequency. It is controversial. Even the booster is controversial.
There's no standard definition for the booster. Normally, what happens if once you give 3 doses of hepatitis B, you will have enough of immune response. Get your healthcare workers, especially, get your NTHBS. If that's more than 10, then you don't need any additional vaccine. This will last for around 5 years. Then, after 5 years, you may repeat an NTHBS.
So it is recommended to do the titers, the antibody titers?
Yes, for healthcare workers, yes.
Ma'am, we are through with the question answers.
Okay, wonderful. I think it was excellent. Pratima, Rekha, you've done an excellent job. The faculty was too good. And I know everybody must have really learned a lot, including the faculty and all of us and all the people who have joined in. It was an excellent session. Thank you very much.
All my faculty has read so much that I was feeling, you know, that what to answer and what not, but I should answer.
No, you didn't have to teach in that much, Pratima, otherwise you would have been teaching only. So everybody knew they've all done their homework so well. So excellent.
Thank you. So for vaccination, no is the bar.
Yeah, excellent. And we've now understood.
Ma'am, Mittal should have faith in me that I'll be able to be moderating this session with such senior faculty being panelists.
Thanks a lot. You did a wonderful job. Questions were quite appropriate.
Claps to you, Rekha.
Great job.
Excellent.
Can I please request Dr. Ramnik Sabharwal to give a vote of thanks, please?
17 Hello. Hours.
Please unmute.
Ramnik, just unmute yourself.
I'm sorry. Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Honorable Dr. Sharda Jain, ma'am, Honorable Dr. Malvika Sabharwal, President, DGF Central, Dr. Harsha Khullar, Vice President, Dr. Jyoti Bali, Vice President, who unfortunately could not be with us today, Dr. Shivani Sabharwal, Secretary, DGF Central, Dr. Payal Agarwal, Treasurer, and all the participants. While we are all eagerly waiting for the COVID-19 vaccine, I think this was an excellent topic of discussion. It is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks for this very informative webinar. I, on the behalf of DGF Central and the entire team and members here together, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to all the speakers for sharing with us their opinions today. A big thank you to Dr. Dinesh Kaul for his participation in the topic vaccines in children. Thank you, Dr. Harsha Khullar and Dr. Poonam Khera for being the chairpersons. I must mention a deep sense of gratitude to Dr. Neerja Bhatla, Kiran Kaleria, Dr. Asmita Rathor, Dr. Girija, and Dr. Jyoti Bhatla for sharing their knowledge with us and giving us an excellent coverage to the topic. I wish to acknowledge our appreciation to Dr. Pratima Mittal and Dr. Rekha Bharti for being excellent moderators. Thank you, ma'am. A big thank you to the entire team of DGF Central, headed by our President, Dr. Malvika Sabharwal, Vice President, Dr. Harsha Khullar and Dr. Jyoti Bali, Secretary, Dr. Shivani Sabharwal, and Dr. Payal Agarwal, the Treasurer, for making it a great show. Finally, I would like to take this opportunity to extend a hearty thanks to Walter Bushnell for the enormous cooperation in the organization of this event. I would like to individually thank Dr. Vishal Vahane, and marketing head, Mr. Abhinav from Walter Bushnell. Once again, thank you one and all.
And Mr. Sayam.
And Mr. Sayam, yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Walter Bushnell, a big thank you.
Yes. Once again, thank you so much to all of you for giving us your time for this wonderful session. And also thanks to all the participants for joining us for this session. And so ma'am, if you allow, can we sign off for the session?
Yes. What was the attendance like, dear?
Ma'am, that I will be sharing with you, ma'am, after ending the session.
Book live also, no, Pratibha will get to know.
Yeah, after ending the session, we will come to know, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Put it on the group.
Yes, ma'am, sure. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Thank you
so much, ma'am. Bye, ma'am.
Bye.
So we are signing off.
Yes.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.